Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 29th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. We have today received apologies from Natalie Don. The first item on the agenda is consideration of whether to take items 3, 4, 5 and 6 in private. Item 6 is consideration of the evidence we will hear today. Item 4 is the consideration of a draft report on the Environmental Standards Scotland Strategic Plan. Item 5 is the consideration of a draft letter to the Scottish Government on environmental common frameworks. And item 6 is consideration of the committee's work programme. Is everyone happy that we take these items in private? Yes. That's agreed then. So the second item on the agenda is an evidence session in relation to our inquiry into a modern and sustainable ferry service for Scotland. Members will have received the clerks and Spice briefing papers on this item. It is our third evidence session for our inquiry into Scotland's ferry services today. Ferry services. Today we're pleased to be joined by representatives of Scotland's business, enterprise, tourism industries to hear their views on ferry services. And I welcome our panellists. In the room today we've got Peter Clark, who's the Deputy Director of Industry for the Scottish Whisky Association. We have Rob Dixon, who is the Director of Industry and Destination Development for Visit Scotland, and Martin Johnson, Director of Strategy and Regional Economy, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, who joins us remotely. Thank you for accepting our invitation. We're delighted to have you here. There are a list of questions from members, or a list of members who want to ask questions, I should say. And I'm going to start it off with a very easy question. And let's start it off to Peter. I'm going to ask you each the same question. So you've got a moment to consider your answers, except for Peter, who gets known. Are our ferry services working for the industries and people you represent? Peter.
Well, thank you. My answer to that question would be no, as we put in our response to the inquiry. The ferries themselves form an essential part of our supply chain. They provide a lifeline to the island communities and to the business which are part of those communities. But the ferries are part of a very fragile infrastructure. The ferries themselves are prone to disruption, as we set out in our response. This can be weather-related, but also related to the age of the vessels. But I think also we need to consider the broader links that the ferries connect to, and it's that inter-island connectivity. And when we step back and look at those other connection points in our supply chain, those parts are also failing. So in the example of Isla, I would say that the ferry is struggling to meet our current demand, but also the roads are struggling to meet the needs of our industry.
Thank you, Peter. As the members of the committee found out yesterday when we visited Arran, and found one of our ferry trips was cancelled and we had to leave before we completed our business. Rob, your answer to that question.
Very similar, I think. Visit Scotland is very much focused on building a destination and visitor experience which allows tourism and events to flourish across the whole of Scotland. And in looking at our islands, we're absolutely clear that part of that visitor experience is the journey to the island in whatever form that takes. And at present, the ferries can offer an attractive proposition, but they're not consistent in providing what is required for the businesses on the island and for the visitors. And I think it's that inconsistency and the unpredictability that comes with it, senses that you experienced it yesterday, that is the major challenge. We've worked increasingly closely with different organisations on the various islands and with other partners to try and address those issues. We've done joint marketing to make sure that the islands are promoted in the best way possible. But there is a vulnerability around that inconsistency of the service, which is very difficult to deal with when it is a week, a day-to-day, week-to-week, a month-to-month occurrence.
Thank you, Rob. And Martin.
Yes, good morning and thank you. I'm not going to contradict what Peter and Rob have said to the panel. When we are talking to businesses, industry groups and community organisations around the Highlands and Islands, and keep this focus to the islands, then they're not satisfied with ferry service, whether those are the inter-island ferries run by the local authorities or the connections to the islands, to the mainland, run under contract by government. I think there is significant room for improvement on that. I think that is our view.
Thank you. Unanimity amongst the panellists. The first questions then from the committee members comes from Jackie. Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for coming along. Could you maybe go into some detail about what impact the recent disruptions to the ferry services have had on island and remote rural businesses, which I'm hoping you'll include in the tourism and distillery businesses as well? If I'm just going to go along the line, if you don't mind. So it'll be Peter, Rob, and then Martin.
Thank you. I mean, in terms of the impacts on businesses, the disruption impacts on the operations of our businesses. So in terms of our distilleries, moving materials to and from the islands on which our distilleries are located. We have heard from members anecdotally this year that so between January and April, you know, we lost production weeks. One company cited 7 production weeks lost, which has a significant impact on that business in terms of its scheduling, its planning ahead for what it intends to produce. We've had similar stories from other members as well. It's also having impacts on tourism, and Rob's probably best placed to talk about that. But we have heard that, you know, having a bad ferry experience can put visitors off. It also impacts on the sort of long-term planning of the industry. So we've seen members investing in island communities, building new distilleries, expanding existing distilleries, and the construction projects have been held up in some instances. We've heard from one member who told us that they waited 3 weeks to get a crane across to one of the islands, and that held up the business, held up the construction of the buildings. So it has those kind of impacts. And it also impacts on the people who work in the industry. We employ lots of people on the islands, and you know the employees are part of those communities in which they live, and you know, it has impacts on the day-to-day lives of people. So I'd say that those are the main sort of headline impacts that we are seeing from this disruption.
I think I would suggest that the impact is in two spheres. One is the here and now, and the difficulty that occurs when you have cancellations at short notice. I think that was probably most starkly experienced in Arran in the early part of the season. I'm sure you heard about it yesterday, and because of the breakdowns. And we were certainly speaking then to business groups on the island and to individual businesses who should have been starting a very positive experience at the start of the season with strong bookings, and actually off the back of 2 years of great uncertainty and great difficulty, and actually the reality was that what they saw was booking cancellations and difficulty in fulfilling bookings. So although people may have managed to get there, they perhaps didn't stay for as long. They were nervous about return journeys, so were cutting short stays. And of course, once you've managed to get that booking and secure somebody coming to the island, the financial benefit then that plays through, both in the short term but building for the medium term, is what's important. In terms of Isla, a typical car spend on the island in their stay is about £1,200. Now, if you start to lose big numbers across peak times of the season at a figure of £1,200, there's a here and now which compounds the difficulties of the last 2 years. But you're not giving businesses the ability to demonstrate actually what their economic prosperity for the future can be once they start having conversations about growing their business, investing in their business. That loss of income will not come back into their books. And so you're diminishing from that point forward the strength of that business, the profitability of that business, its ability to be sustainable and its ability to invest in its own future and, of course, the future of the island. So there's two things that immediately come into play in terms of the impact. The first is a loss of income, and the second is this diminishing of the ability for the island and businesses on any of the islands to sustain their growth because of the restriction that's placed by the ferries.
So you think long term is going to be as big an issue maybe as the short term?
I think the medium and long term piece, we might come on and talk about more of this, is actually now more important in terms of the work we do now, and that's not in any way to dismiss the short term, but it's to recognise the importance of contributing to strategic thinking for the medium and long term.
Thank you. And Martin?
Yes, thank you. I'm going to pick up Rob's theme in terms of the here and now and looking ahead to the future. So just to pick up some of the evidence that we provided in our written submission. So looking back to last year and one of our business panels that looked at transport in particular, then almost three quarters of island businesses rely on the ferries. And with two thirds of the businesses on the islands say that reliance and resilience is the most important to them. And from a business survey of this year, so across the region, then two thirds felt that transport links were a risk to their business. And it's been well documented this year in particular, where that aspect of reliance and resilience has failed. It's just not been there. So businesses have not been able to move people backwards and forwards on the ferries, and they've not been able to move freight backwards and forwards on the ferries. The ferries have suffered from success in so much you've seen strong growth, particularly in freight. We're aware that the freight on the Orkney ferry has doubled since 2011, and the freight on capacity on the Shetland Aberdeen, for example, last year it grew by 15% between 2020 and 2021. And just continuing that theme on the Lerwick Aberdeen link, then the ferry's running at 90% capacity in terms of 6 out of 10 ferries running north, and at 90% capacity of 4 and 10 ferries running south. So there are real limitations on the here and now of businesses to operate. And again, it was well documented, and we heard from Rob the impact that's had on tourism, certainly on the Clyde and Hebride ferry service and islands and businesses served by that this year. And I think the aspect on tourism, the aspect on the a lack of ability to rely on the ferries is impacting right across the island economy in terms of aquaculture, seafood in general, seafood processing, and tourism, to pick up on that, and also agriculture. It's key pinch points in the year. Something like 70% of all the livestock movements from Shetland, for example, take place in 2 months, September and October. That coincides with roughly a third of the agricultural movements from Orkney. So it puts real pressure on the ferry service and then on other businesses for 2 months of the year, so 1/6 of the year. And when we look to the future, we're aware of sectors offering not just opportunities to the island economies, but things like offshore wind, to look at the development of Scotland's hydrogen economy, aspects to do with space, that's particular to Shetland and the Western Isles, the continued growth of aquaculture. Also, I don't think by any means has the tourism sector plateaued in terms of its economic benefits, and also the decommissioning of offshore oil and gas structure. All of these industries, to a large extent, will rely on good ferry connectivity, that resilience and reliability absolutely being there. And for some of these sectors, the players in this are multinational businesses. And the point that I make there is that the boards of these multinational companies will have multiple investment decisions in all places all around the world. They will have choices where they invest their time, their effort, and their cash. And if Scotland can't demonstrate to these key sectors that the islands are a location for them to invest their capital, because they can rely, or they cannot rely, but we really need them to rely on carry connectivity. There is a risk that they won't make the investment decisions, so we won't see the full economic benefit from offshore wind, from hydrogen, from decommissioning, for example, at land in Scotland and land in particular in the island economies.
Okay, thank you. So can I ask you, in your view, what do you think businesses and visitors want from a well-run ferry service, and how do we achieve getting the balance right for both businesses and visitors? Sorry, Martin, so you can't see me looking at you. Sorry.
Yes, Jackie. Thank you. I think a large part of the answer to that depends on the process going forward. The extent to which the Scottish Government, Transport Scotland, engages in a meaningful way with island communities. And when I say island communities, I mean it in the broadest sense. So individual community groups, business associations, businesses and stakeholders. And that engagement has to be meaningful, so they have to both listen and hear what is being said to them and develop a service on that. And the decisions that are taken, in my view, need to be transparent and open so that the people in those communities can see why decisions have been taken. I should say that I am an islander, although I live in Inverness, I am a Shetlander. And people that live on islands, they know it's not going to be a Rolls-Royce service. They know that there are choices to be made and everything that is wanted is not affordable. There is a balance to be struck. People know that, and it's one of the things that you accept when you live on an island. But the decisions that are taken that affect the vital transport links have to be open and transparent. People have to understand why decisions have been taken. And they might disagree with those, but at least they would understand. So the process there is really important, and that picks up on some of the existing structures around about the Island Ferry Board, the Ferry Stakeholder Group, the HiTrans, ZTrans, and Local Ferry Committee. So the structures are there, and they're well used, and they're represented by good people and business people on that. So the structure's there to help design the service. And I think it's through speaking to those people that are most directly affected and most directly invested in a fit-for-purpose ferry service that the design of that will emerge, both figuratively and literally in terms of the type of vessels required.
Okay, thank you. Can I go to Rob now, please, with the same question? And then I'll come to you, Peter.
Thank you. I think Martin's put his finger on really what the most important facet here is. My most recent background was a decade at Scottish Borders Council as Director of Economy and Infrastructure, and I was therefore involved at the Council as the Borders Railway was brought back into being. And whilst I believed prior to that experience that the investment in infrastructure to allow social and economic development was a good thing, my experience in the decade in the Scottish Borders was that it was profoundly important for sustainable social development and economic development. And my experience of speaking to businesses and working with public sector partners where there was that process of transparent engagement over the medium and long term that Martin referred to has made and will continue to make, I am sure, for the decades ahead, a difference to the economy of the Scottish Borders. Sat here, I see no reason at all why a similar process of engagement and discussion shouldn't strengthen the island economies in relation to tourism and wider business interests better than we are experiencing at present. And I think above all else, it is that need for strategic thinking and planning about the development of sustainable economies and the part that tourism and business and community and domestic requirements need that is most important. There's a lot of detail I could go into, but I think in principle, it is that need for a more coherent and medium-term focused discussion between strategic partners, government agencies and significant business interests like SWA that I think is currently not present and could help a considerable amount in terms of planning the future.
Thank you. Peter?
Thank you. I'll be echoing a lot of those points. I mean, essentially, we're looking for a modern, robust reliable ferry service. I think there's three elements. The reliability and resilience piece is well known, so I won't explain too much about that. I think the second point from a business perspective is capacity, but also capability and flexibility of the ferries, and I can just explain a little bit about that. So in terms of the capacity, it's meeting current but also our future needs, but also having an understanding about how business needs may change. So I can give you an example. A distiller who builds a distillery on an island in the initial years, it will be distilling that spirit. It may well put that spirit into a tanker to be removed off the island onto the mainland for maturation. But over time, that distiller may build warehouses on the island. So over time, its demands for the ferry will change from requiring empty tanks to be taken to the island, which would then be filled and removed, to requiring empty casks to be taken to the island to be filled, to be removed. So you can see in that business's sort of model how its requirements will change subtly, and that will have a subtle influence on the type of freight that is moving to and from. And just another example as well is that transition to net zero. So the industry is fully committed to decarbonising our operations, and it's possible that in the future we might be using the ferries more for transporting alternative types of fuel. So it might be a stepping stone fuel. So at the moment, if we take Isla as an example, a lot of the fuel that's consumed on Isla is delivered by a tanker to a fuel depot on the island and then is distributed by road. But in future, as distillers look to transition towards net zero, we might have demands on the ferry for transporting alternative fuel, so a stepping stone fuel like LNG or even hydrogen. So it's having that flexibility in the system to be able to manage that different type of freight demand. And then the final theme, I think, is, and it's been touched on already, is about communication and engagement. And there are there's a good example of that, and there's a couple of examples where I could elaborate and give you an idea about where there's room for improvement. So if we look at Isla as an example, to accommodate the new vessels, improvement works are needed at Port Ellen, which is one of the two main ports on the island. And the engagement process on that has been really good. We're involved and engaged in a reference group. We're able to feed our views in on that and looking at the different options that are coming forward for the design of the port and the terminal and the facilities there. And that's good, and that's a good model to take forward. On the other hand, I would say on the vessel design, we've had very little engagement on the design, feeding in our business needs for the new vessels, particularly for the Isla route. But also in terms of timetabling and also vessel scheduling. And we have a live issue at the moment on Isla. So we normally have two vessels which run the Isla service, the Finnlagan, which is a more modern, a larger boat, and the Hebridean Isles, which is an older boat getting towards the end of its serviceable life. We're down to running one vessel, which is the Finnlagan. And the issue that we have as an industry is because the way that ferry has been designed, it can only accommodate one of our spirit tankers. So at the moment, for each sailing, we can only move one tanker of spirit from the island to the mainland. And that's having an impact on the members' operations. We're urgently looking at solutions to that. But had better communication happened, and you know, we'd known about this further in advance, it would have enabled our members to make sort of plans and mitigate against the impact that we're now facing. So again, that comes down to this sort of communication and engagement with key users of the services.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener. That's all I have.
Thank you, Jackie. We'll move to you, Liam, now, if we may.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Martin Johnson, the current network of ferry routes has barely changed for decades. Thinking specifically then about the existing routes, in your view, do the routes that we have meet the needs of business? And in any event, are there any significant route changes that might improve the offering?
Thank you. That's a good question, and I'm hesitating to know if I have the right answer or an answer for you on that, Liam. you are absolutely right to say that the routes have been the routes for a very, very long time. Now, I think we would recognise that the connection points on the mainland, you know, if you're travelling from the Western Isles, for example, then where you land on the mainland, you still have a very significant journey ahead of you to connect into either road or rail for onward travel of people or of freight. At least, I put it this way, at least when you land from Shetland or Orkney to Aberdeen, you are connecting into a major transportation point. So you are able to connect on by air, road and rail through a good network. So there is a compare and contrast there when you land in Newark, for example, or even Ullapool. You have a very significant distance and time ahead of you before you arrive onward. So there is something to be considered in terms of where might the ferries land, and again, what would a good onward connection look like there. In terms of your question, does the routing serve the needs of business? I guess my answer is I don't know, and that the consultation through the structures would be the way to go on that. So I don't really have an answer for you on that, Liam, because it's not something that has come up in our consideration or that I'm recalling that has come up in conversations with communities. So I'm afraid I haven't got a very expansive answer for you on that one.
Thank you. Rob Dixon, Peter Clark, do either of you have anything to add on that?
I think in terms of the routes and the ports, the infrastructure is where it is. But I would say on from a business perspective, in terms of the actual use of those routes, more frequency could be considered. But also we have had conversations previously with third-party operators who have looked at running, you know, third-party private route services, to other locations. So it could be, say, connecting Isla to the Clyde estuary, some of the ports in Ayrshire and so on. And that's something that, you know, has come forward as a proposition, but as yet nothing has emerged from that. There are certain benefits of that in terms of taking road miles off some difficult roads like the A83, the Rest and Be Thankful, and connecting directly into the sort of the motorway and the dual carriageway network for those onward journeys. You know, that as I said, is our conversations that we have had, but as yet there are no alternatives certainly on the Clyde and Hebridean network.
Thank you. Rob Dixon, yesterday, as you heard, the committee had a very good and very productive visit to Arran. And we heard about the unpredictability that you referred to earlier and how it impacted on businesses' ability to get staff to their island, and also teachers and educational provision for their young people. Can you tell the committee, is that impact that the committee heard about yesterday being replicated throughout the network in your experience?
In terms of the short cancellations or the on-island impact?
In terms of the ability of islands to recruit staff, in terms of the attractiveness to people, skilled staff to get over to islands?
I think it's fair to say that we're probably experiencing labour challenges within tourism and hospitality that have not been experienced in recent years across the whole of Scotland. So the position on the islands is an acute version of what is happening in Scotland. That is compounded by two factors that businesses consistently cite. The first is transport, and ferries play a significant part in that, and the second is housing. So I think it's a combination of factors, which, come back to my earlier points, diminish the ability of businesses to be as financially sustainable as they should be on an island, as financially successful as they could be on an island. The ferries play a critical part in that in terms of employment and skills and labour, but it's not the sole restricting factor. And perhaps there are bigger factors at play in terms of overall population demographics as well as housing. But the ferries are a factor in there in terms of skills and labour and employment.
On a related point then, Peter Clark, you talked earlier about the long-term implications of what we're seeing with the existing ferries. Can you tell the committee what are the implications, in your view, for the islands of an inability, as we've just heard, for whatever reason, to recruit qualified staff and skilled labour?
Talking to members, in terms of recruiting staff, one of the challenges is accommodation and having accommodation on the islands. That has been certainly a key barrier and a key challenge to getting people to work on island locations. I mean, there are some examples which we can give where our members have invested and have built new distilleries on islands and have actually led to, you know, significant economic growth on the islands, offering you know, high quality, good paid jobs, skilled jobs in these island locations where few are available. I visited a distillery about 6 weeks ago on one of the islands. It relies entirely on the CalMac service for everything it needs, as does the island. And that distillery is now employing about 20% of the island's population. But when you actually dig into that figure, it's more interesting than just that overall figure. It's the fact that it's leading to people moving back to the islands. It's repopulating the island. But there is that acute shortage of accommodation, and you know, temporary measures have been put in place. There have been to sites where members have needed to put in temporary accommodation, static caravans, for example, as a short-term measure. So you know, those sorts of measures have been introduced, but accommodation is certainly one of the challenges for attracting people.
Martin Johnson, do you have anything to add to that, or shall I hand back to convener?
I'm happy that you hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Convener.
Just before we go on to the next question, one of the issues that we heard yesterday, which built on what Liam was asking, was that a lot of island businesses rely on external contractors to come in and do work, and they load up their vans the night before, turn up at the port in the morning, find there isn't a boat, and then find that the boat at the back end of the day is shut down due to weather conditions. And they were suggesting that there were businesses that were no longer prepared to work on islands on the basis that they couldn't guarantee a full day's work, and the costs of doing so were prohibitive. Is that, Peter, what you're hearing, and Martin, what you're hearing from people you represent? And what are the effects on the business? I mean, you can't have all your own specialist skills to run all the businesses you represent, Peter.
Yeah, I think it certainly is a challenge in terms of, you know, getting people on where you have those issues with the ferry. I mean, distilleries themselves, they tend to go into maintenance shutdowns where we sometimes need to bring contractors over, and members have reported, you know, problems there. But it's about scheduling. Trying to find accommodation for contractors can also be a challenge on the islands. So it certainly makes it more challenging for the members to operate.
Used to have a flight, didn't you? I remember catching it to go over to one distillery that used to do Inverness, Glasgow and Islay, and it was sort of used by all the main distillers on Islay. Does that still operate?
There are flights to Islay from Glasgow, and I think that, well, there certainly used to be in recent years a service from Edinburgh.
Basic route organised way, which was accepted as a distillery type flight to get people out there.
Sorry, I'm not aware of it. There was a
okay. Sorry, Martin.
Yeah. So I'd say the short answer is yes. Convener, I think anyone living any business on an island would recognise if you have to bring in services from off island, it's much more difficult to do, much more difficult to organise, and from the supplier's point of view. They have to price for time, and they also have to price for risk of either not getting on or not getting off. And these issues can be particularly acute where it's sort of more significant construction projects, and just the availability of civil contractors to come to an island to move material, move men. Move equipment can be very difficult and can be very, very costly because of how the supplier prices for risk on the connection to the island in a way that they just wouldn't do if they were travelling by road.
Thank you, Martin. Very helpful. Monica, I think the next question is yours.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our panel. We've heard already some of the challenges for people and business, both short and long term. I want to ask each of you if any of your organisations have concerns that the current level of ferry service provision may be fueling depopulation in island and rural communities. And if so, can you identify where this is happening and what needs to change to reverse any such trends? I'll come to Martin, then Peter and Rob, if that's helpful for broadcast. Martin.
Monica, thank you. I think undoubtedly connectivity problems, lack of reliability, lack of resilience, is adding to the challenge of island communities retaining or bringing people to live on them. Typically, that's the smaller islands, so islands off an island or the smaller islands off the west coast of Scotland, where it just adds to the challenge. Amongst certainly Orkney and Shetland, it's not just the connectedness to the island, to the mainland of Scotland, it's also the local authority ferries. I think for both, well, for the Argyll Council run ferries, Orkney run ferries, and Shetland run ferries. Too many of the ferries are over 30 years old, so they're breaking down. They need maintenance. The reliability just isn't there. And that means that particularly an island off an island, or indeed an island off an island off an island, then it just becomes much, much harder to live there. The opportunities to commute for work just aren't there. So it is a significant factor. The absence of a reliable ferry service is a significant negative, in so much that it makes it much harder to retain or to bring people. And the flip side of that, if there was a reliable ferry service, if islands were better connected in terms of frequency, in terms of reliability, and in terms of resilience, it would be easier to retain and to attract people to come and work in those islands. I think you're asking for specific examples. I suppose we could certainly look at the likes of Thetler and Hunst and Shetland, and the southern Uists are a good example of that as well. And it's an area, certainly, if you're interested, we could look to provide more information to the committee on that. But the short answer is yes.
That's helpful, Martin, and we're always looking for additional information, so feel free to send us a letter after the meeting. Peter.
Thank you. Well, I think there's many factors which will have an impact on demographic change, and connectivity is one of those. In terms of depopulation, it's something that I'm not... I don't have the answers I think that you might be looking for, but just to reiterate the point I made previously about the growth in the industry, the Scotch whisky industry, where we're now seeing distilleries being built on islands where we haven't had distilleries. Those distilleries themselves are generating economic opportunity. They're generating jobs, as I said, and are contributing to a shift in population. So in our sector, perhaps it's a little bit in reverse. But overall, as I said, the factors are probably very varied.
Yeah. Not much to add. I think the point I would make is, and it relates to a couple of earlier comments, that our view is quite clearly that the full potential of tourism is not being realised on the islands. And if that full potential is not being realised, then the full employment potential is not being realised, and therefore the ability to either attract people to the islands or to retain people on the islands is not being realised. And I think it's a straight link between these factors, in which, as we've already discussed in answer to previous questions, the ferries play a part. They're not the sole thing that will address this, but they play a significant part in the diminution of businesses to be able to effectively develop.
Thank you. Rob, earlier on you talked about your experience around infrastructure-led projects, and clearly you're quite passionate about that. You may be aware the Scottish Government recently published its commissioned research that examined other examples, including how Japan tackled island depopulation. And I think in Japan, they had switched from infrastructure-led projects to focus on tourism-led and then back to infrastructure. I just wonder if you have any sort of thoughts on, you know, you've talked about the importance of infrastructure. What else could the Scottish Government be doing?
I think we've seen through the introduction of the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, Ms. Hislop will be very familiar with it, the ability to, I think, generate interest and engagement on how infrastructure is developed. Now, that can be quite modest changes. We're not talking about multi-million pound investments here. We're talking about small investments, perhaps a few hundred thousand pounds, which can allow changes, infrastructure changes that give businesses greater certainty and bring benefits to residents, domestic users, etc. There's very little that happens for the benefit of visitors that isn't of benefit to those people living in a community. So that force for good that tourism is can be developed off quite modest starting points. I think ensuring that we encourage councils to develop their infrastructure plans specifically in respect of tourism, and ensuring the Scottish Government continue to invest in the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, as they have done, is a very, very important part, particularly in the current economic circumstances that we have. I think that Building for Growth in the Future part becomes very important in the next 2 to 3 years.
Thank you. Now, I wanted to move on to another question to ask if there are any routes where enhanced air services or fixed links might be a realistic alternative to ferries, or at least as part of an enhanced ferry service provision. I'm going to come back to Martin first, because as well as the written submissions, I've been aware of some press activity in the last sort of 24 hours. So understand that Highland and Island Enterprise are suggesting that, you know, fed up islanders should maybe turn to air travel and a push for cheaper flights. Really just want to give you a chance to expand on that, Martin, because there's been a bit of media coverage. Are things that bad now that we have to, as you put it, or your organisation puts it, look at sustainable aviation as an alternative here?
So thank you. So, yeah, looking beyond the headlines, what we're pleased our written submission to the committee being aired through the media. So yes, in response to some of the questions posed by the committee in our written response, we do bring out some points on the opportunity for flights, and that was a reiteration of our response to the consultation on Scotland's aviation strategy earlier on this year. So islands, by definition, you have to cross water. So if you're not doing it by ferry, then an obvious alternative is by air. And all the main island groups are connected to the mainland by air. And residents are able to take advantage of the air discount scheme, which gives them, I think, up to a 50% discount to travel to the mainland which was a significant help to the cost, and also helps the viability of those air routes. The point that we're making, and it also goes back to not just an anecdote, but some of the evidence we've got, that about a fifth of island businesses say to us that they rely on air travel to do their business, to move people backwards and forwards. Business travel is not covered by the air discount scheme. And if members of the panel have ever had to personally travel to the islands, you know, it's very, very expensive to travel to the islands. Air travel is very expensive. So there's an extra cost to island-based businesses when they have to travel by air, either because of the timing of things or because they can't rely on the ferries. So we're making the point that an alternative, an option, is to fly, and the logic of the air discount scheme to residents to help them live on an island and to travel and to connect to the rest of the world should also apply to businesses. So that's the point we made in our written submission to the committee, and that was the point that we made to the aviation consultation earlier on this year. Then within the islands and fixed links, absolutely. I think island communities would rather have fixed link than either an air link or a ferry link, just because of the absolute convenience and the reliability. And we've seen that across, in particular, the Western Isles and where some of the southern archipelago was connected by causeways. So we're aware that in Shetland, for example, there is, again, active discussion about connecting some of the islands up, Yell, Unst with the mainland, Wolsey, whether that be causeway, bridge, or tunnels. The challenge there, I guess, is what appears to be a more expensive upfront capital cost relative to replacing aging ferries. And I go back to what I said, that the fleets are all, the median age is into the early 30s. But it depends over what life cycle of replacement of ferries you look to compare and contrast fixed links. So it absolutely should be part of the mix, should be part of the consideration as we look, or Transport Scotland looks at their island connectivity plan, is the role that fixed links could play to replace and enhance some of the ferry links. As I said, we've made the point about business travel and air.
Thank you, Martin. I'll stick with you for another moment. Just to ask, so thank you for your further explanation, Owen, the role that fixed links could play. Does Highland and Island Enterprise have any estimates or data on the potential economic impacts of the construction of the type of links that you mentioned, or could perhaps share that with committee later?
I don't believe we do, but I'm aware, certainly by speaking to Zetrans and Hytrans, very happy to come back either with what they've got or it would be a nil return on that, but I'm very happy to come back with that later on.
That's great. Thank you for that, Martin. I'll turn to Peter and Rob just to see if you've got anything to add in terms of the role of fixed links and, I suppose, what sustainable aviation looks like as part of this conversation. Peter?
Thank you. I mean, I think in terms of air, it does play a part in island connectivity. It currently plays a part in island connectivity. Obviously, for a business that relies a lot on freight, our freight will be staying on either a fixed link if one was available or on a ferry service, I would imagine. But in terms of moving personnel, air is part of the current mix. And I think, if that sector were to grow, the focus would need to be on that sustainable element of it, sustainable aviation. In terms of fixed links, We as users don't have much influence, I suppose, on what fixed links might be feasible. Certainly interested to hear if any are under development. But at the moment, I think there's just two islands that are connected to the mainland with a fixed link. So there's limited sort of scope at the moment.
Thank you, Peter. Rob?
Little I can add, I don't think the important assessment of this should be around the sustainability issues and the transition to net zero. And whilst in the long term, I suspect, we may see the possibility of fixed links, depending on the cost of that, actually in the short and medium term, we should be working incredibly hard to try and make the transport that's utilised by the islands as emission free as we can, reduce the emissions, and any assessment as to whether it's by ferry or by air needs to factor that in. And I think we're working very hard to try and make sure that the travel undertaken by visitors, either in coming to Scotland or once they're in Scotland, is as sustainable as is possible, and within that context then assessing whether ferries to certain islands, air to other islands is helpful, should be part of what's considered, I think.
Thank you. Before I hand back to the convener, I just want to ask Rob something, because Martin's mentioned a couple of times the age of some of the ferries, you know, more than 30 years old. From a Visit Scotland perspective, what impression does that make on people who are here for tourism or people who are travelling within Scotland? What sort of feedback do you hear about the ferries?
I think the age of itself is not that significant to the user. It's the condition and the journey experience, and both the departure point experience and arrival point experience. We've had discussions with CalMac quite recently about how that can all be enhanced, both on ferry and at departure and arrival points, as well as the pre-booking digital experience. I think all of that can be enhanced. Now, I don't necessarily think the age per se is a barrier there. It's about actually how you invest in the service that's provided on the ferry, what that experience is. But I think particularly what the experience is at ports as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. The next questions come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Thanks. I wanted to ask you about whether you see there's a need or even a responsibility for business sectors to be managing travel demand while at the same time, you know, focusing on business growth, focusing on productivity as well. And I was struck by, I think, what you were saying earlier, Peter, around development of maturation facilities on Isla might be one way to reduce travel, transport, freight demand. Rob, I was also struck by, I think, a growing phenomenon of people perhaps taking two or three cars to the islands on holiday with them. So I wondered sort of if each of you could perhaps offer some thoughts as to whether you think it's responsibility of government just to meet, you know, endless demand, or whether there are actually ways that we can be managing that demand in a smarter way. Do you want to come back in first, Peter, on that, given that you...
Yeah, sure. I mean, in terms of the maturation point, that will change the nature of the freight, but ultimately that spirit will need to move off the island. You know, there will still need to be that transportation element, albeit it could be in a 10 years time or whatever the maturation period for that particular spirit is. I mean, in terms of managing, the travel demand, we ultimately need to move product to and from the islands. You know, we need casks on for maturation. If we're maturing there, we need empty tankers, we need cereals, we need to remove other products, including the spirit, the byproducts, we need fuel and packaging where we package on the islands. So I think it's very difficult to kind of manage the actual volume of materials that we need. So that was sorry,
what about waste,
the byproducts,
draft and water?
Yeah, the draft does need to be removed from the islands if it's not used locally in the local say the farming community, those byproducts do need to be removed. There are alternative uses of those byproducts, and it is possible that they could be used and stay on islands in which they are generated. But when we're looking at Isla in particular, where we've got 9 operational distilleries, draft is one of the products that we currently need to remove from the island. And it can have an effect. If you can't remove the byproducts from the island, then that would need to be stored, and that can have a knock-on effect on the production process itself. So actually, removing the byproduct, say draft, can actually impact on your production process. So it's important that the system works efficiently, so that we've got the inputs and the outputs flowing as efficiently as we possibly can.
Is there a way to square that going forward? Could there be, other processing or infrastructure investments that could make things more circular?
Well, as I said, in future alternative uses of distillery byproducts is something that is continually being explored, particularly on the transition to net zero. So, that's potentially one element that could reduce that need to move byproducts from the island.
short answer to your question is yes, and the demand management piece is a critical part of island capacity and making best use of available infrastructure. So I think intuitively my sense would be more can be done. We're already seeking to head in that direction with the marketing that we are doing under the Tread Lightly heading, which again links to my previous comments about encouraging lower emission travel, particularly emphasising the desire to travel somewhere in Scotland but stay longer. In other words, overall reduce the amount of travel, but as a consequence of staying longer in the context of an island setting, of course, spending more money on the island over the period you're there, and that relates to that sustainable economic development point that I made earlier. I think there should be a discussion with the island communities and the ferry operators about the sophistication of the ticketing model. We're all pretty used as consumers to quite sophisticated ticketing models in all manner of ways that we purchase tickets, not just for travel, but for events and many other things. And I think the islands quite rightly should think about this and consider how that ticketing might reduce demand in terms of volume of transport, but also then favour certain types of transport at certain times. And I can imagine in the years ahead that fuel type of vehicles would be a factor, capacity of vehicles would be a factor, length of stay might be a factor. Of course, hand in hand has to be the focus of businesses on the development of their product, the sort of itineraries that are offered on islands. So if you're going to be encouraged to stay for 5 nights, not 3 nights, what is it that's going to be available to you to do? So that destination development thinking and product development thinking, I think, has to be a part of what can be driven through as demand management. But I think there are options there which could be considered, but they must be underpinned, going right back to where we started, by a reliable service. Otherwise, they will fall at the first hurdle, I regret.
Thanks for that. Martin, from your perspective, you're obviously working with many different sectors, including rapidly growing sectors such as offshore wind. What are your perspectives on how we create the space for that development?
So thank you for the question, Mark. I think on the principles and the benefits of the circular economy and the just transition to net zero, the short answer is yes, that's part and parcel of how we manage demand and to manage capacity. And my sense is from the work that we do that industries and businesses are moving in the direction, that is a direction that society as a general is moving in. That said, islands are microeconomies. So unless they can produce and consume that which they need, failure that has to be imported or exported. And that so there is an irreducible amount that will have to come in and come out on the ferries. And when we think about what is sustaining and opportunities for the future, things like aquaculture, seafood processing, for example, then the output of that for human consumption has to leave the island and it has to go on vehicles and on the ferries. So that's an example where there is an irreducible amount of demand reduction through reduce, recycle and reuse and the just transition to net zero. But beyond that, I think that the islands, more broader point, you have a really important role to play in the emerging economies. I mean, there's in Shetland, the Orion project is, I think, a very, very exciting and interesting example of both the decarbonisation of the production of oil and gas. That's by no means an oxymoron. And also related to that is the production of green hydrogen, not green hydrogen just for the use within the local economy, but to produce on scale to service a global nascent industry. And of course, much of the offshore wind will take place around the coasts of our islands. And to see that happen and to service that nascent sector, it will require people and goods and materials to pass on the ferry. So the ferry connectivity, the ferry service, ferry capacity, the islands will have a direct role to play in a bigger picture of net zero. And as I said, businesses are moving towards net zero and the circular economy. But by their nature, islands, that there will be a point where the irreducible point that goods must come and go by ferry.
Thanks for that. I've got another couple of questions. I'm just going to wrap them together for the sake of time. So firstly, about the fare structure for commercial businesses, what are your thoughts on how that could be reformed? And then secondly, just about the responsiveness of ferry operators, not just CalMac, but other ferry operators as well, to the needs of business. If you can point to good practice, if you can point to how that could be improved going forward. Martin, can we start back with yourself again, go in reverse, is that okay?
Yeah, so my understanding is that Transport Scotland are going to be having a look at fares across all transport modes across Scotland. So harking back to what I said earlier on, through consultation with the various committee boards, stakeholder groups, Hitrans, Ztrans, then that's an important discussion with businesses and industries about the costs of fare for businesses as well as for residents. On the point of responsiveness, I think on the whole, my sense is on the whole, when people engage with CalMac staff and they engage with Northlink staff, it's a really positive of service, and that's an accolade to both organisations in terms of the customer experience when they talk to people, notwithstanding aspects of reliability. And I certainly think in terms of responsiveness, again, because I know it best in Shetland, how Northlink, the seafood sector, agricultural sector and the haulage sector work together very collaboratively over September and October, when the bulk of the agriculture, the livestock, are moved, is a very good example of flexibility, of goodwill, of collaboration. So I'm aware that that works, and that works to overcome the challenges of capacity constraints at that time of year.
Okay, thanks, Rob.
I think the responsiveness of both Northlink and CalMac in work that we do with them is good, and I would echo what Martin says. I think when we have conversations with them and we develop joint work with them, the engagement is very good. Most recently, we've done a joint-funded paid marketing campaign with CalMac, a total campaign of £40,000 in value, with very, very impressive figures achieved. And I think that demonstrates that as a national tourism agency, you know, working with organisations like CalMac, we've done similar with Northlink in the past, we can achieve great outcomes. I mean, some of the viewing on the kind of organic social media here is 10 million people over the months of August, September, October converting into almost 500,000 engagements with that product. That's comparable to anything that we can deliver in any sector. So the demand for islands and the ability to work with the organisation, I think, is there. On the fare structure piece and the interface with commercial, I think my only comment on that would be that too frequently tourism is seen as domestic travel. It's a business. And therefore, the tourism piece needs to sit firmly within the framework of discussion about economic development and businesses, because although it may be you and I as visitors or holidaymakers that are travelling to the islands, actually the purpose is a business purpose from the end business that we're going to stay with. And I think that thinking and that approach needs to be factored in a bit more.
Thanks, Peter.
I mean, just on the responsiveness, just going back to the point on communication and engagement, the point I made, you know, in terms of the Port Ellen work, exemplary, very, very good level of engagement, room for improvement on issues like scheduling of vessels, as I mentioned, the issue that we're currently facing. I would say that, you know, we welcome and we're welcoming more engagement with CalMac in particular, as the operator for the islands where most of our distilleries are located, and that's something that we would certainly encourage. In terms of the question on fare structure, I don't think I have much to say on that particular matter. Obviously, fares is commercial matter for you know, members to decide on in terms of, you know, what services they use. But we can certainly do some further work and come back to you if that would be helpful on those points. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. And I'm actually really interested in all the answers you're giving, but I noticed the clock doesn't slow down with the interesting answers that you're giving. So I'm just a bit conscious of time, so I would ask you just to bear that in mind. There are some questions I would like to ask, but I'm going to give way at this stage, probably rightfully, to the Deputy Convener to let her get her questions in, and then I'll see if I've got time for mine at the end, which I'm sure there will be.
And I've got lots of questions, I'm sorry, Camilla. and I want to come to all of you, but I'll come to Martin first. The committee is conducting this inquiry so that we can help inform our view for the connectivity plan that's forthcoming. So I want to focus on future thinking, and we know we want sustainable economic growth, we want repopulation, and we also want to deliver net zero. So that's the framing, which I see you're all nodding to, that's helpful. So I want to come to Martin first and also look at specific links and areas. But first of all, can I just ask Martin, what involvement has Highlands and Islands Enterprise had in the development of the forthcoming connectivity plan?
We have conversations with Transport Scotland, and we have connections through the likes of the Ferry Community Board and local committees. But I'm not aware yet of us being, stand to be corrected, but I'm not aware of us formally engaging with Transport Scotland. But we would look forward to doing so, yeah. And we believe we would have clear views with evidence to bring, yeah, to that.
So clearly we want strategic alignment that anticipates future opportunities, but also have to have that flexibility to get there. And we have different industries. So let's take the Northern Isles in particular. You've already raised issues about cattle in particular and times of years. What can be done in terms of that transportation for improvements in future planning and existing freight, but also, as Mark Russell was referring to, the new industries, the current industries of energy and space. So what does future look like for the Northern Isles in terms of what would be optimal?
So I think our view on that is that looking to the medium term, then the replacement of the two freight vessels would be an opportunity to look at the dimensions, the carrying capacity of that, and also the mix of freight and passengers. So we think that certainly looking at, I think it's called Freight Plus, where you have essentially freight carrying vessels, but they can also carry passengers. And I think in our written submission, we give an example of sort of 200 passengers being carried as well as a substantial amount of freight.
Then switch to Allopool Stornoway, that kind of route and the businesses, yep, that are involved in freight there. What would future look like in terms of success for those criteria we've mentioned?
I think we echo the views of others that we believe there's a business case to be explored for an overnight freight vessel. And we're also aware in the very short term, i.e. next year, that there'll be two points when UEG is closed for the works. There's going to be a lot of pressure on the Allopool Stornoway. Additional short-term capacity may need to be chartered in. But longer term, and essentially now going forwards, we think that an overnight freight vessel would on the Allopool Stornoway would substantially help alleviate capacity issues there.
And also, I think you want to make sure that these routes are attractive to the new workforce that will be needed for those new industries, I take it?
Yes, indeed. And again, I go back to what's important is consultation. We stand ready and willing to help Northlink and CalMac and Transport Scotland engage with industries and businesses of the now and the future. It's what we do and very much look forward to doing, so that the needs of those industries are built in, and as far as possible, the capacity and capability of the fleet serving the Western and Northern Isles is future-proofed.
Okay, thank you. And I'll move to Peter Clark now and ask about Islay and the whisky industry in particular. Clearly, we are seeing great successes with the whisky industry in Islay, very much dependent on the brand of Islay, so they depend on the island itself. But if we have a subsidised CAMAC service, that effectively means that the public purse is subsidising the freight traffic for the profitable whisky trade. Do you see there's any role for the whisky trade in helping manage demand, as we've heard, but also in identifying where those subsidies should be, or would they be more interested in direct freight, dependable, reliable freight that might be through private tender, for example?
Thank you. I mean, in terms of Islay, it does have challenges from a freight perspective, capacity being one of them, and reliability. I would say that you know, the current ferry is the only service that is available. We do move some of our materials to the island. There's a grain boat which comes into to Port Ellen, and I mentioned the fuel as well, which is used by ourselves and other people on the island. I mean, in terms of alternatives, as I said, you know, we have you know, spoken, and we are aware that there are potential third parties who could offer an alternative freight-only service running between Islay and the mainland. We did do some work back in 2009. We funded a project with Argyll and Bute Council and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, which was a whisky logistics study, you know, looking at the current situation, what the issues are, and looking at potential future growth, and then coming out with some recommendations and solutions. And in terms of, you know, one of those solutions, one was for a freight-only service to be run. In terms of that service, you know, there are attractions certainly to that, and again, the commercial element will come into play. But we also do need to be mindful that if the Scotch whisky volumes, which provides essentially a lot of base load for the Islay service, if that was to be removed from the Islay service onto another service, what impact would that have on the CalMac service? So that's something that, you know, would need to be certainly considered, and it's something that you know, we are mindful of. But, you know, as I said, you know, we are open to conversations. We're happy to facilitate, you know, conversations between members and third parties if a service looks to be viable. We would need to step back from the detailed contractual terms. The trade association, we couldn't engage in that, but certainly happy to make those connections.
And then turning to Rob and to ask your view about that balance between freight and passengers, and reflecting some of what we've heard already, we were familiar with fly and drive, but clearly sail and drive with electric cars on the other side may be the way forward from a net zero point of view, if you've got large numbers of family groups coming over to Ireland. So what does future look like for you?
I think fundamentally the future has to be placing net zero at its heart of the thinking, and we need to find a better balance between the needs of residents, of businesses, and I'm including tourism in the business piece to be explicit, and that freight use. And certainly from our perspective, considering the overnight use for freight seems to be an obvious option to explore, as Martin indicated. But I think recognising the needs, the seasonal needs, the time of day needs, the day of the week needs between different sectors is critically important. And I think we lack some sophistication in the models that we're using and in the dialogue that's happening around how actually markets can be better supported in the way that services, as they currently stand, and that's not to suggest they should stand as they are for the future, but as they currently stand, are best used for economic development purposes of the islands.
More sophisticated, calibrated, strategic and flexible system between industry and business, yeah, and the transport is what you're asking for, and I see you're nodding to that.
Yes, thank you.
Martin's trying to get
in. Oh, sorry, Martin. Do you want to come in on that side?
Very, very briefly, I did qualify that subject to contradiction, and I have been contradicted, so we are engaged more formally with Transport Scotland on the island connectivity plan. And it is along the lines that outlined of data and connections.
And once I've got Martin, I just maybe want to contradict you as well, potentially. You talked about perhaps looking at main links for transport being hubs, whereas shorter ferry crossings, but with renewable energy, either by electric vehicle or eventually hydrogen vehicles on the other side, would actually be a better net zero solution than necessarily everything coming into major hubs, like you used the example of Aberdeen, but shorter. Yeah. So is that something that you're aware of? Because that contradicts a wee bit what you were saying earlier on.
I absolutely think that these emerging, more than emerging technologies are part of the mix of how we look at sort of modal connections between ferries and terminals. So yes, I think that absolutely will be part of the mix. And I know that in particular, island communities are very, very keen on the sort of greening of the islands. That is something that island communities seem to me to be taking to heart. So I'm definitely sure that will be part of the mix. And so see no reason why it would not be. And you're just too welcome.
Thank you, Martin.
And Martin, well done. No one noticed you being kicked under the table to correct your earlier answer with more information. But Liam wants to come in with, I think, with a question on the back of that.
Just very briefly, thanks, Convener. Martin Johnson, you talked just there about being consulted on the island's connectivity plan. Are any of your organisations consulted on the spec of future vessels being brought onto the route? And in any event, who do you believe is consulted? And of all of those that get consulted, who has the loudest voice? Martin Johnson.
Liam, thank you. I don't know how well competent we would feel to be to comment on ferry design. But again, subject to clarification, I don't believe that we are formally or even informally consulted on what you think of this design or that design. I think where that is best put is through some of the structures I've already mentioned, various community board, stakeholder groups, HITRANS and ZETRANS, which would bring together stakeholders to talk about what they need in terms of the characteristics, capacity and capability of the vessels. That would, and they would also then beyond the sort of characteristics, that there would be people that are informed on vessel design. And in terms of who has the loudest voice, I guess it's Transport Scotland. And I think that goes back to my very early statement that my sense of speaking to people in preparation for today is that how island communities are consulted, listened to and heard, and then how decisions are prepared and choices are whittled down and ultimately made has to be improved. Because my sense is that island communities do not feel ownership of key decisions that are so material to their well-being, to their economy and to their society.
Very grateful. Rob Dixon, Peter Clark, anything to add? Or
I'm not aware that Visit Scotland have been consulted. I'm not sure we would have much expertise to contribute. And because we're not involved in that process, I'm not clear about how it's managed or the loudness of any voices within it, I don't think.
Thank you.
Just in terms of the vessel design, as I mentioned, under communication and engagement, we certainly weren't involved in any sort of systematic or structured consultation on the design feeding in our needs. I mentioned we co-funded this study which looked at volumetrics for the Isla route, but having that sort of detailed nuanced conversation with users, hauliers as well, because a lot of our freight is managed through the hauliers, just to understand behind the numbers. It's not just the tonnages, it's not just the number of vehicles, but it's the type of vehicles as well. So I would just make that comment on engagement on vessel design.
Very helpful. Convener.
Thank you. I'm going to push a bit on this bit, if I may, is that we seem to have gone for just on the route that we were on yesterday, we seem to be going for a bigger ship, 102 metres in length, compared to the Caledonian, 30-year-old Caledonian Isles, nearly, which is 94 metres, and the Hebridean Isles that serves that, that is 84 metres. So we seem to be going for a bigger boat with an increased passenger capacity. When we heard at a previous meeting with Western Ferries that they favoured the idea of having smaller boats that they could make sure were full and were operating full and flex up and down as required to meet demand. Peter, would you support more flexibility in delivering the reliability and resilience that we believe islanders demand and rightly demand for their ferry services?
In terms of flexibility, in terms of the actual services themselves and not in terms of the vessels, but you know, if you're looking at flexibility, one of the things that came through from the Isla Logistics Study was that there is a need or will be a need for a freight-only service. And it doesn't have to operate 5 days a week necessarily. It could be 3 days a week initially, and that can be flex. It's having the flexibility to manage the services. But in terms of the actual size of the vessels, certainly for Isla, you know, the vessel size is increasing, you know, that's been part of the process. I guess it's a longer crossing, roughly 2 hours, so it's not a relatively short crossing where you can have sort of frequency, you know, number of vessels operating. On the Isla route, we do have two vessels normally operating, but they operate over a longer distance. So it's a slightly, I guess it's a slightly different type of service.
Particularly to you, Rob, do you think the flexibility to flex up and down when there's demand, so boats aren't running it half full, is the way forward and it allows more maintenance?
I certainly think increased flexibility in the system would be beneficial. There's, I think, a need for all of us to recognise the challenges about the ferry services themselves being financially sustainable. And I think trying to find the most efficient way of securing that as an outcome is an important part of the equation. In some routes, on some routes, smaller vessels with more frequent services may well be the answer, but there's a delicate balance between the length of the journeys, the type of vehicles and the frequency, particularly in relation to some of, for example, Peter's members, to be met there. The tourism piece, I think, can fill the gap in many ways, but it has to have a core position as well when you get to summer months. So that ability to flex is highly desirable, I would suggest.
And Martin, do you have a comment on that?
I don't want to be a stock record, but I think the islanders themselves are the best people to speak with authority about what they need from the ferry service in terms of support, in terms of size and capacity. That said, certainly I tend towards, from the discussions I've had with people, that bigger isn't necessarily better, and that you know, two vessels rather than one large vessel is better, both in terms of overall capacity and also builds in resilience and redundancy. And on a sort of side point, I think people do speak, from what I've heard, positively about the on this aspect, in terms of the two new ferries that are being constructed for Islay and the proposed two new ferries for the Uig Triangle, is that they're all essentially sister ships, so they are they can be used the different vessels can be used on the same routes, they can all dock to the same infrastructure, the crew are all trained in the same way, and the operability and redundancy, or I suppose resilience within the system, is therefore much better. So that to me strikes me as being something sensible and to certainly consider long and hard as we think about the overall nature and makeup of Scotland's fleet. But there will be horses for courses, and ultimately the islanders are best placed to say, in my opinion.
That's very helpful. And just, Peter, I want to come back to you and then ask a general question to everyone to close it, if I may. Demand has never been greater. We heard as far as your industry is concerned on Isla and doing particularly well, and freight demand. Is it getting to the stage where you might have to consider purchasing or acquiring the services of a ferry operator just to service your industry to give it the reliability that it needs?
Well, as I said earlier, third-party operators have approached us have looked at putting on a service. Those conversations took place sort of 2-3 years ago before COVID struck. And ultimately, it would be up for a third party to decide if that was compatible or fell in line with what their expectations would be as an operator of that service. But as I said, we are open to facilitate conversations between the members and third party operators.
I think what we heard yesterday was concern that if people did come along, that they wouldn't be able to use the facilities because of the restrictions placed on them on the use of those facilities by current users. I don't know if that's a problem we can find out. Finally, if I may, Rob, I think you said at the beginning that a bad ferry experience is not something you get over quickly, paraphrasing your words, if I may. And there are a lot of people out there who may have had bad ferry experiences in the last few years. We heard yesterday it'll take a long time for people to get over that. How long do you think that is, Rob?
I think we've got challenges in the marketplace that make tourism more difficult to predict in the years ahead than perhaps it has been, certainly up until the period of 2019. It is fair to say that over the course of this summer, tourism has not fully recovered. There are parts of Scotland where recovery is strong, but there are parts of Scotland where recovery is much weaker. On the islands, as I said at the beginning, your paraphrasing is accurate, I think, Chair, that they have had a set of challenges which are unique and particularly difficult to deal with in the short term, and are undoubtedly, listening to the businesses operating on the islands, a barrier to visitors. Demand and interest is very high, and the most recent campaign that I mentioned with Carmike demonstrates that quite conclusively. So the ability to ensure that actually we have a ferry service which, if it doesn't meet the demand, at least caters realistically for the demand that's there at the moment and is reliable and predictable, I think is critically important. And as long as we continue to have the problems that we've experienced, then we will continue to see visitors voting with their feet in decision-making about not visiting the islands. So I can't answer your question with a definitive timescale because I don't know when that more reliable service will be available. But I think it will pay dividends if it becomes available because the demand for visiting the islands remains strong.
Sort of 5 years, do you think it would take that long? If the service suddenly became perfect today, would it take 5 years or 2 years or 3 years?
No, I think it would be pretty quick. I think if the service became perfect today, to quote you, I think you would see bookings coming forward and demand for visiting recovering very strongly, perhaps even next season, because what we see with the marketing that we've done and the interest in social media is demand to visit the islands is there. But I think people are put off by either what they see in the media or some experience in some cases.
Martin, do you want to comment on that in relation not only to tourism but to businesses doing businesses on the island?
I guess if we're in the scenario that we've waved a magic wand and it's a reliable, robust ferry service, my guess it would take a sort of a whole season of that to sort of address the sort of negatives that people would have experienced previously. I think for those who've had a bad experience, they would need the kind of show me type answer to be persuaded that they're not going to get the same experience again. So I guess in that sort of scenario, one season would probably do it for them.
Peter, do you want to add anything to that?
From a whisky industry, I guess we're a long-term industry, so members have invested in islands where we're facing difficulties at the moment, and that's part of the industry that we are a part of. So I guess not really too much to add to that.
So there's huge pressure basically on getting this right as soon as possible, and industries will respond to that and pick up from that. But the longer it goes on, the more difficult it will have been that for those industries to just survive as a whole. And I think on that note, it's probably a very good point to end it. I'd like to thank you, Peter, and Rob, and Martin for giving answers to the committee today. Really interesting. Time has flown, and it does when you're having fun and interested in the subject. So thank you very much, and we are now going to move into private session. Thank you.
Thank you.